Parashat Vayechi. This too is an amazing portion of the Torah, the conclusion to the magnificent book of Genesis, a deathbed scene which is one of the most spiritually uplifting that one can imagine. Because what had been a very fractionalized and almost dysfunctional family, by the end of Jacob Israel's life, are united in a common goal to act as one in the creation of a nation. E pluribus unum. From the many, the 12 sons of Jacob will become one nation, Israel. What goes into making this nation one? Something very strange occurred. And it occurred specifically in the blessings of Jacob Israel. You have to remember that the brother who was slated to be the leader of the family, the one who would bear the legacy of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, was to be Joseph. That's why his father gave him the cloak of many colors. That was a symbol that he was to get the firstborn legacy. You remember that in the past, there was always one brother who was X'd out. Yishmael was X'd out by Sarah and then by Abraham at God's behest. Isua was X'd out. Rebecca said that the physical blessing and the religious spiritual direction of leadership must not be shared, but must be in the hands of one. Because messianism, to bring the Messiah, to bring redemption, to teach the world the word of God from Zion and Jerusalem, requires a material, physical infrastructure. The material wherewithal and a good army in order to make certain that we are enthroning compassionate righteousness and moral justice and not allowing evil to usurp power and strength. And so she had Jacob, the more bookish, the more spiritual, the pure-hearted son who was the dweller in tents. She had him put on the garb of Esau, at least externally. And it was that Jacob who received from Isaac the legacy of the blessings and the birthright. What happens with Father Jacob, grandfather Israel, when he's giving out the blessings? One would think he would certainly follow the way in the footsteps of his mother. One would think that Joseph would receive the physical, material blessings and the religious direction of being the master of his brothers, the leader of the family, with eyes towards messianism and world redemption. That's not what happens. Joseph is two tribes. Joseph does get double, in effect, two portions, whereas each of the other brothers get only one. Joseph has beautiful material superiority. He has the lush area within Samaria, the wealth. However, he does not get religious superiority. Yehuda, ata yoducha achecha. It is to you that your brothers will give fealty and homage. And yishtachavu lecha b'nei avicha. The children of your father, the sons of your father, will bow down to you, not to Joseph. Ad ki yavo shilo, v'lo yikatamim. Until true peace will arrive and the ingathering of all the nations. Messianism. Redemption. Spiritual superiority. Yaakov makes the same split that Isaac wanted to make a generation before. Not like Rebecca. What happened? And I'm going to say this very telegraphically, but I think you will understand me very well. Rebecca made a very good argument. You've heard it from me before. Rebecca felt that both of the gifts, the material wealth as well as the spiritual leadership, must go to the same individual. And the runner-up has to be ejected. Because you can't have two warring leaders. That may be the case when you're dealing with individuals. But when you're dealing with a family about to become a nation, then there is a very different thing that one must remember. And perhaps it's something that one must remember even when one is involved in just one family. Rebecca wasn't right. At the end of the day, Jacob pays a very dear price for his deception. Deception vis-a-vis Esau and deception vis-a-vis his father. At the end of the day, the brothers deceive him. And they claim that Joseph has been torn apart by a wild beast. Joseph deceives him by posing to be the Grand Vizier. Laban deceived him by giving him the wrong wife. In our place, we do not give the prize to the younger before the elder. He's constantly being deceived. He pays heavily for his sin of deception. And in his old age, at the end of his life, he understands that when you have a family, you don't eject the runner-up. Because the runner-up also has strengths that should be used within the family. There's one brother of the 12 who understands the tremendous unity of the family and who brought this fractionalized family, who brought this dysfunctional family to the stage of the unity that it is at the end of Parashat Vayechi, at the end of the book of Genesis, and that was Judah. Yehuda knew exactly what to say to his old father in order to convince the father to bring Benjamin to Joseph, to the Grand Vizier, that would bring at least all of the brothers together in one place. Yehuda said, I will take responsibility. Miyadi tevakshenu, anochi yarvenu. I will be the responsible one. And it was Yehuda who figured out that the Grand Vizier must have been Joseph. It was Yehuda who got Joseph to reveal himself and to forgive the brothers and to bring forgiveness to the entire family. When you're dealing with a family that is turning into a nation, there dare not be an ejected brother. There must only be forgiveness and unity. And this is exactly the note upon which the book of Genesis concludes.